Yeah, continue.
I'll continue. Okay. So if you look at the archives on the Scheduled Caste Federation, you will see that from the early 50s, there is notes sent by the Home Department and the Intelligence Department to the government to find out what are the Scheduled Caste Federations, how many of them are active and operative in districts of Bengal. It coincides with Jogendranath Mandal's coming over from East Pakistan to West Bengal. Now, he is still perceived as a threat. He did not succeed much in garnering that support, because obviously his support base is still not here that way, and they are refugees. The most important identity at that point of time was that they were refugees. So they could be, you know, won over by different political parties and all these, but those who were with Jagannath Mandal says that Mr. Mandal was able to garner a lot of support in that way, but yes, still never won from there.
And he was elected once, no? Like,
that was before partition.
Oh, that was before partition.
Yeah, and there was a lot of politics in what kind of seat would be allotted to him, given to him.
Okay.
Because he was first given a seat where there was not a single refugee there.
Okay.
So he refused to. And then you know, there were two left groups.
Okay.
The Shatbam and others, 7 and 8.
Yeah.
One was CPI and the other was CPM.
Okay.
So then the CPM gave him the seat, I think at Barasat, which he lost. And his electoral agent said that it had got everything to do with first caste and then with the organizational disunity of the left. But with Mandal's death, with Jagannath Mandal's death, everything was seen to have been under control. And the only, if you want to talk to Kanti Vishesh, you can, because he told me about this, that the only ministry ever in West Bengal that did not have a single scheduled caste minister was the 1977 Left Front Ministry. It was only after central Dalit leaders and intervened, and there were deputations from West Bengal on the need to have an SC, the Scheduled Caste Minister, in the cabinet, that Jyotibasu agreed. Till then, he said, what's the need for that? We don't need them.
Yeah.
But then, it was only then that Kanti Vishesh was taken in first, as youth and welfare minister, and then he was given the portfolio of primary education minister. And it was when he was given this education portfolio, primary education, okay, not even higher education, that Alimuddin Street got flooded with letters saying that all Bhadraloks, all upper castes, they wrote to Pramod Das Gupta, the left chairman here, that we do not want a Chandal son to head the education department. They have no problems with maybe even finance, they have no problems with home, they have no problems with youth and development, which welfare, which Kanti Vishesh had handled. This, not with education, we refused. And he said that I read those, and you know, he becomes very emotional nowadays. He's grown old also, and obviously this hurts a lot when you even recount. So he was saying this, and he got very emotional when he said this, that you know, this is Bengal 1977.
Yes.
And
like in your article, you were specifically saying about how the no caste myth in Bengal was propagated by Bhadralok, and also specifically how partition did away with their challenge at that.
Yeah, partition, I was telling how it did away, because you know, first is that you take that entire population away, keep them away in East Pakistan.
Okay.
And when they came, they got the worst deals, right? Because the best deals was already taken by the upper caste.
Yes.
Very few quote unquote this lower, so-called lower and untouchable caste scheme after 47, between 47 and 48, very few of them, who got some good deal, but as if you would like to talk in terms of community and in terms of majority and all this, then they got a very bad deal.
Okay.
They would be placed outside, not only outside the city, in uninhabitable areas.
Okay.
They would have to clear the forest, clear the area, build colonies, stay there. Okay?
Okay.
And you would see all these colonies outside the city, on the outskirts and on the fringes and deeper inside,
okay,
were all untouchable caste
okay
colonies. They had come from East Pakistan after 1950.
Okay. They're still there.
Yeah. Go to Mothopuram, go to Barasat, and the interiors, go to Bonga, that's a completely border town.
Yeah, yeah.
Which is, the population is mainly Scheduled Caste population. The Motiya Mahasangha has their office, their headquarters there. And yes, it's very much, if you look at the development and disparities in terms of caste, I'm sure you would be able to tell them.
And how, could you please explain more about left and the scheduled caste, because in your article there was this, the left geo was acting something jeopardizing caste, there was no caste in Bengal and things like that.
First is that the left tried to create its base among the refugees.
Okay.
To win.
Yeah, yeah.
And Ross Malik has detailed the whole Vadijapi massacre. And it was the left which claimed that why would Bengali refugees go to Dondokaran? They should be resettled in Bengal. They were fighting the Congress regime.
Okay?
Okay. 1977, the left comes to power, and these refugees, that's Malik also, Malik talks about this, that sell off whatever belongings they have to buy tickets or to, you know, just to ensure that they can come over to Bengal.
Okay?
They go through treacherous paths and come to Bengal only to realize the policy of the left front, the refugee policy, has been reversed.
Oh.
And they were forced to go back.
Okay.
They had already sold whatever they had to come here.
Okay.
Which means they have already utilized that money also, the meager amount
yeah
that they had got out of their belongings after selling their belongings.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay? So many were forced to go back, and those who managed to sneak in, and in Morichappi Island, many of them gathered and, you know, they started developing their own industry, you know, small scale, cottage industries and all, without government help. That's a very important point that Ross Malik underscores, that without government help, whatever they could from their own resources and hard work. Okay, because Namu Kshatriyas and the Pondra Khatris and all of them were called upon all the time to clean the jungles, make the land habitable and all this. So they could do that. They had that kind of experience. Okay.
Okay.
And they were doing that in Dondokaran and elsewhere. So they could do that and develop small-scale enterprises. Okay. In 1978 or 79, the government sends the police force and there's a massacre.
Okay.
Of scheduled caste.
Okay, of scheduled caste. What is this
Morichappiya massacre?
Morichappiya.
It's
it was under the left
regime. 1978 to
79. Oh. Okay. What happened? How many people were killed? Why were they
massacred?
They were asked to go back. That is why.
7,000.
7,000 people.
See, there is one article in EPW by Anu Javis.
Okay.
On this, and there is this article you find on the net. It's downloadable. Ross Malik, RSSMALLICK.
Okay.
It's on the Morichappi massacre.
Okay.
It's on left front policy reversal and the Morichappi massacre.
Okay.
Refugee policy reversal and the Morichappi massacre.
Okay.
He details the whole thing and all that went into it. And you should also read the George Chatterjee on how this massacre became in fact possible and many other dimensions to it.
Okay.
That was one.
Okay.
The media was already Bhadralik media, right? And while they were not sympathetic to the cause of the refugees, they wanted to, you know, put pressure on left government and all this. But otherwise, this first Morichappi massacre, and then, you see, if they are not given that kind of, allowed to settle in proper lands, how will they pose a challenge in the first place? They would be in the most backward regions, trying to first ensure the survival. And if you are like concerned only with the survival, then it's so uninhabitable, the regions.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
If you are already placed under such conditions, it will take you time to give a political resistance, offer political resistance.
Yeah, that is why.
By the time you can consolidate, right?
Yeah. There was like post-partition, the issues became rehabilitation and
yes.
Those the political things were gone, no?
Yeah, so how to rehabilitate, where to rehabilitate,
yeah.
What to give them, you know, kind
yeah.
of thing. So, thereby the first question becomes only survival.
Yeah.
Where will the politics of resistance be? And even if it was offered, because obviously Modi Chappi offered resistance, that is why it had to be brought down that way.
Yeah.
But then, see, that's what happens, right?
Yeah.
They could not put up that effective challenge.
Oh.
A resistance, because their very presence seemed to be very threatening.
Yeah.
That, oh, well, then there might be more refugees coming in. And refugees as such were not a problem. But their caste identification was a problem, that they
yes.
were Dalit refugees.
Yes.
Who had a history of challenging Bhadralok dominance.
That made it a problem.
In 1946, Jagaron carried, that's the weekly periodical that the Scheduled Caste Federation brought out.
Mm.
Now there is a good deal of engagement with the understanding of what sovereignty, what nationalism, what independence means. And you know, it should have actually, if you look at the kind of engagement they had, this was completely in terms of class, that this is a national bourgeoisie government, and the British interests, capitalist interests, would be best served if they stopped directly ruling India, instead had a national bourgeoisie regime. That their interests are very left communist party kind of discourse that they were engaging in, and they were putting forth that. So this should have definitely called for an alliance between the Scheduled Caste Federation and the Communist Party. No. The Scheduled Caste Federation is considered as engaging in identity and divisive politics, reactionary politics, and Ranadive in that his pamphlet meant for internal circulation only on the nature of the Scheduled Caste movement in India, calls upon them to unite under and come under the banner of the Congress to fight for independence. But their idea of independence is vastly different from the Congress's idea of independence. And it theoretically comes very close to the Communist Party's understanding about what it should be like, the understanding of independence. But then, instead of going with that kind of a theoretical understanding or even engaging with it, you are very dismissive of this. Yes. The position is that it allowed this kind of situation in West Bengal on the part of the Dalit refugees allowed, and the way Jogindranath's presence was being undermined, all this allowed for a further consolidation of Bhadralok politics through the left.
So the left could only the left was a means for the Bhadralok politics. It didn't have any other like it mainly consolidated Bhadralok politics.
Yeah, it was mainly consisted of all Bhadraloks. You see how many lower caste or Dalit state leaders do you find? Not a single.
Even now?
Even now.
There is no single Dalit leader in the left. Okay.
In West Bengal. All the heads of the local committees, the regional committees, district committees, not regional, sorry, district
yeah.
committees, and the state committee, just find out how many Dalits are there.
So, if
no, no single Dalit leader you can take.
So, are there minor violences? Like how does the left look into these organizations of the Dalits presently?
See, first is they try to co-opt.
Yeah, that's.
So, there have been efforts at bringing them under CPM control, left
yeah.
control. Not that they have not been successful, but not to a great extent. Not to an extent they would want to. And so there has been a lot of, you know, dissenting voices, which of course the left did not take into account. And if we are to go by what the Kondrupathrius are talking about in terms of the electoral defeat, the reversal of left fortunes, is because of the kind of voting pattern on the part of the Scheduled Caste population.
Okay.
Yeah. But the point is that they also argue that while we have been the kingmakers,
okay.
we could never become the kings. we continued to play second fiddle to Brahminical domination. And if you look at them seriously, the kind of portfolios the Dalit ministers got in the left, successive left governments is not important ones actually. Higher education, not a single Dalit could become a higher education minister. Forget the chief minister, home ministry, finance ministry, nothing. Even land reforms ministry, something very close to Dalit interests.
That was not given to them. Yeah, the same thing happens in Kerala where a tribal leader is given the Ministry of Scheduled Tribes.
Yes.
That is, they are limited there. They are not allowed to, you are speaking about hegemony. How does this hegemony, this counter hegemony of the of the scheduled castes, where successfully done by partition was one mode of it, left using its power is one mode of it. What is the present status? Like, are they uniting themselves?
Unfortunately, there are Dalit organizations which do not have a common platform. I mean, there are many Dalit organizations. There are too much of problems.
Ideologically,
in terms of aims, in terms of methods, and in a certain sense, as I've heard from Dalit elders, Dalit veterans, that there's also something called personal vested interest, which prevents a kind of unity, because it calls for some kind of sacrifices. That if I'm going to leave this place and give that person the place, and that will ensure some kind of unity, I won't be doing that. That is something which, they themselves say that it's very, you would have seen that. I said yes, but maybe if I say it, I could, because I'm not a Dalit. So it might become okay, I'm saying this because I'm being critical of them. I've never tried to place myself in that kind of situation and see through their lenses what the problems are. But if they themselves say this, and these are very old people who have been with the movement, kind of, built the movement, they would be saying that yes, there is of course problems with that. And the refugee problem is still the most important. With the 2003 Amendment Act, it becomes
The refugees are not, the majority of the refugees are scheduled castes, not this Kharis, those and those people. Majority is.
Because you see, it's 6 or 6.5% of the Bengal population.
Okay.
They are Brahmins, Kayasthas and Goyals, the upper castes. Okay. Only 6 to 6.5%.
Okay.
And Shantosh Rana's book in Bengali on West Bengal Scheduled Castes and Tribes. I think, if I'm not mistaken, the Dalit population as of now in West Bengal is above 21%. It's much higher than the national average. It comes only second to Punjab.
Okay.
It's higher even than UP, the Dalit population. Yet, they're unable to, as in UP they have been able to, in Bengal they have been unable to pose even a serious challenge. They have to kind of ally themselves with dominant Bhadralok interests. So again, you see with the, seriously, if Motilal Mahashanga is so important for this ruling group, then why is something as unimportant as refugee resettlement, which you cannot do without the concurrence of other departments like finance and home and all these departments, is given to scheduled caste persons and food minister.